Hello students and teachers, this video is in continuation to the previous video on telescope and its design. Here we will focus on what are different parameters such as the limiting magnitude or resolving power of a telescope. So let's dive in. So first of all, let's try to recall why do we need a telescope in the first place compared to our eye. So telescopes have much larger aperture, much larger diameter. It helps in two things. One is it allows us to have a much clearer image of distant object, and second, because it has larger collecting area, it allows it to collect more light and therefore it has more detail and allows us to see fainter images, right. So as I mentioned, this is a diameter dependent property of a telescope, and that governs two things, something called resolving power and something called the limit of what magnitude stars it can see. So an eye can typically resolve stars which have angular separation roughly of one arc minute. So if there are two point objects that are closer than one arc minute, the eyes won't be able to resolve them as two distinct stars. Just for clarification, 1 degree consists of 60 arc minute, and similarly 1 arc minute consists of 60 arc seconds. We generally measure this angular separation in arc seconds or arc minute. Another point to note here is even if point object is very small, our eyes will make an image of it that is roughly 1 arc minute thick or in diameter. So for you to able to resolve two distinct stars, their center to center distance should be around roughly 2 arc minute. Even if the point object is much smaller than this 1 arc minute size, it will still be resolved as 1 arc minute in diameter. Okay, and why such thing happens? This has to do with the diffraction property of the light. The light behaves as a wave. So since light has a wave like nature, once it sees a circular aperture, instead of having a single spotlight like image in the end of the screen, we see concentric bright and dark patterns. And the size of the central airy disk is governed by the diameter of this aperture. Even if the source, the point source is very small, is point like, we will still see this much size of an airy disk and this pattern. Typically for eyes, these patterns are dim enough, so you don't see it in daily observation. However, what issue it causes? If two point sources are very close to each other, these patterns, they interact. If they are far apart, then we will still be able to resolve them. We will be able to identify these two are distinct. If they are just close enough, we will see that they are just resolved. Once it gets to a close enough proximity, we reach a point where it is just resolved. Beyond that, it becomes very hard to distinguish whether this pattern is due to one source or two distinct sources. There are some advanced data analysis techniques that allows us to resolve this, but I will not go into detail. The minimum separation, angular separation, that allows us to resolve is given by this Rayleigh criteria. It's the formula comes out to be 1.22 wavelength of a light. In this simulation, we assumed it's a monochromatic light, it's a single wavelength light, and wavelength of that light divided by the diameter of the aperture. Okay. Note, this formula will give you the resolving power in radians. The dimension of or units of both lambda and d should be in same units, and this works only for the circular aperture. Where does this 1.22 comes from? Often this is a very common question by students. So this 1.22 comes only for circular aperture, but typically you can use it for varied, because it's not expected from students to know and able to calculate for all shapes and design. So moving on, just for reference, if your aperture shape is of circle, then we have seen how the pattern looks like. But this shape, if it changes from circle to square, your output is vastly varied, hexagon, triangle, all these we see something that doesn't match, and that 1.22 number will also change for each one of them. So therefore we don't use any generalized formula. Rather, whenever a telescope or an observatory or space telescope are being designed, these things are very thoroughly investigated and calculated. However, many of you would have noticed that telescope has a secondary mirror, and secondary mirror often don't hover in the center. So they are connected by some rods, we call them spiders, and these spider rods, they also cause diffraction spikes. And what happens is, if you have spider of this shape in a horizontal shape, you will get a diffraction pattern in vertical direction. This is how the wave diffraction pattern looks like. If instead you have a typical cross like spider, then we see the cross like diffraction spikes, and this is the reason why stars photos in many of the images have these nice beautiful spikes. Beautiful for some, not so beautiful for astrophysicists who are trying to study them. If we come to JWST, for example, it consists of segmented mirrors. Each different mirror has its own diffraction pattern along with the spider it has for the secondary mirror. Now what it will cause? It will cause this very vibrant diffraction pattern for individual mirrors and the spider, and we see this horizontal spike as well, along with all the hexagonal shape of the spikes. So what you would notice, if you see a JWST image and zoom it quite a bit, you would see all these pattern, individual spikes from segmented mirrors and spikes from the spider. This may appear nice and beautiful for some, but those who are trying to study stars next to these spikes, often it creates a lot of challenge in data analysis, but it requires a large amount of computational powers to get rid of them and get a scientifically accurate measurement. So scientists don't like these spikes much. Okay. Now if we compare different resolutions for different telescopes, so if we see images, three different images of exact same region by three different surveys, CRTS survey that used 0.68 meter diameter telescope, PanSTAR 1.8 meter telescope, SDSS survey 2.5 meter telescope. Don't be alarmed, stars are not black and sky is not white yet, but astronomers like to see these images in inverted colors, because spotting a black dot, a faint black dot in white background for human eye is often easier. Anyways, so if the resolving power is too large, the value is too large, then what will happen if two stars are very nearby? It will be hard to detect if that dot is due to one star or two star. And then if you would like to study population survey of some cluster or galaxy, then it will be a problem. For that you will require much better resolving power, so the theta minimum in Rayleigh criteria is less as well. So if the diameter is large, it collects large amount of light and focuses it, you will be able to detect much fainter stars which you won't be able to see otherwise. However, you may be able to see much more fainter stars in CRTS, and that is because it had some advanced data processing techniques used, and with those techniques you could see much fainter objects as well. So this is how different telescopes could be used to either detect fainter stars or number of stars. So if we summarize, what diameter of the telescope or the mirror or the aperture gives us, one, it gives us resolving power. The lower the value of this theta minimum, the better the telescope resolving power is. And the other is limiting magnitude. What is the faintest star it can resolve? So if you look at this image of Pleiades cluster, you would see a lot of stars nearby, but the telescope that took the image was able to resolve. You also see diffraction spike due to the spider of that telescope, and how much fainter stars you are able to resolve also depends on what how large the telescope was. So this is what telescope governs, and that's all for this video. So if you have any comments or any questions, please let us know, and if there is any topic you would like more detailed video on, please let us know in the comments. Thank you.